It's a nice spring morning. The birds are all over the place, very active this morning. And they don't seem very angry. Just obsessed with the business of the day. Pretty much like everything in this world is obsessed with some sort of programming that they're carrying out. And it's difficult for us to conceive that all of this doesn't really have any meaning. We assume, well, there's so much activity, it must be profound in some way. The amazing thing is that it's not. How long have birds been waking up in the morning and singing? How long has the sun been rising? You see, it just goes on and on and on. And since human beings, human bodies have relatively newcomers, even though it actually stretches back a long ways, we think maybe we have some purpose here. But actually, the planet, all animation, animate happenings and inanimate happenings on the planet, here, throughout the cosmos, is simply like a movie. Very vast, huge production, like a play for the purpose of spirit to watch it, for spirit's attention, awareness to be focused on it, so that spirit can forget what it is, so spirit can fall into deep forgetfulness. That is the purpose of the world. There is no other purpose. We try to project purpose onto it, and we have done that in many, many different ways, saying that it has some great design to it. The great design is the design to induce great forgetfulness in spirit of what it is. So as we wake up to a beautiful sunny day here in California, spring morning, almost spring, and we say, wow, what a beautiful day. Birds are happy. Everybody's bustling around. Enjoy the day. What we're waking up to is forgetfulness of what we are. And our aim is to forget the world. And this is done by choosing the overlay of the world. So even though the world, everything is still there, exactly as before, it's now experienced with an overlay. And our prime experiencing is the experiencing of the overlay. And simply noticing that it's not affected by anything in the world. There are no exceptions to this being not affected. That's the new purpose we give the world. We gave the world the purpose of inducing deep forgetfulness in it, and now we can give the world the purpose of inducing great remembrance by choosing a new idea of not wanting to be prime creator. Very simple. It's so simple, it's easy to forget. Because we see this world and we say, look, there's so many things we can do with this world. We can be so creative here. Make so many things, do so many things. And link everybody up and find out what everybody else is doing. And seems like there's so many possibilities here. But we forget in our effort to accomplish something that the only purpose this world really has is to distract us into deep forgetfulness of what we are. And as we continue through life trying to do all sorts of things, there's another, that's a goose that just flew by. We forget what we are. We go through life after life after life in deep forgetfulness. I wonder if anyone can bring to mind anyone they've ever met who has truly remembered what they really are. Or has it all been people in walking around in, like, as if they were asleep, deep forgetfulness? And going back through history, you can see everyone's been in a deep, deep, deep sleep, like a severe coma. Simply by the fact of identifying with this world and bodies in this world, paying attention to that, spirit paying attention to that. So every day is like this deep coma. We're trying to awaken from the coma of forgetfulness. This world paints a picture completely opposite of reality. This world is like opposite of what our home, our true home is. It's like an island, a survivor island, full of ghastly horrors and things that make us, you know, really severely forget what our true home is like. We're so struggling here for survival. There's no struggle for survival in reality at all, none. So as these bodies struggle for survival here on this little island we call Earth, and we're paying attention to this, thinking that it's consequential, it has meaning, it has purpose, it's important, it's our identity. Our identity is at stake. We are deeply forgetful of our true identity. These are just the basic facts. And yet, you'd be hard-pressed to find anyone who is conversant in these basic facts. We teach reading, writing, and arithmetic in school, and yet, do we teach the basic facts of existence? No. Those are the things to be excluded. This is the basic facts which are excluded from one's curriculum in this world. The basic questions: what is this world? Why are we here? Who are we? What's our purpose? What's the meaning to all of this? What are we supposed to be doing? All those basic questions, we ignore them. They're ignored. As if somehow they'll all sort themselves out. But they don't. Don't sort themselves out. We have to actually make the effort to focus in on these questions and find answers to it, find the answer, find out what's really going on here. And it's so unspoken in this world that it is very difficult at this time. And yet the responsibility remains. You cannot default. You cannot declare bankruptcy on your search for truth. Many feel that if they die, that's it. They're released from all responsibility towards truth. It's not true. That's just another episode of deep forgetfulness. It's part of the disappearing act. Spirit believes it can disappear from the mind of God, can separate from it entirely and disappear from it. So now Spirit, to prove this and to reinforce this notion, identifies with bodies, and then the bodies die and they seem to disappear from the stage. And the Spirit thinks, ah, the body is, the self has disappeared from me, from what I was looking. The one who was looking at it, now it's disappeared. Spirit says, aha, you see? That's how things are. Effects can disappear from causes, can separate and then disappear from them. Completely gone. Now the world is unfortunately gone in a direction of deep forgetfulness. It's very heavy right now. Really too heavy. Everyone is being affected. It takes a gigantic effort to not get pulled down right now by the density and the heaviness of it all. The heavier it gets, the more the ego advertises that things are getting really great, that we're all lightening up, that we're ascending, etc. No, we are sinking. Collective collective consciousness. the collective consciousness of the planet is sinking very, very badly. It's becoming more active, yes, but in becoming more active, it's becoming less contemplative, less self-reflective. How many simply spend the morning like this, sitting in a very beautiful place, very calm, peaceful, nothing happening. No aim to do anything, go anywhere, say, meet anyone. Simply reflecting on truth. Is that supported by the culture that is of extreme activity? You look at those who are pushing the, who are plowing the fields of culture, of civilization in this world. They spend their morning chugging Red Bull, energy drinks of all types, stimulants, pushing each other relentlessly toward action, activity, more and more code. So let's produce more code, more laws, more regulations, more expectations, more activity. Yet the greatest activity is to cease from that, all that activity, to sit quietly and reflect on truth and see this quiet scene through the eyes of reason and clarity. That is the appropriate activity for what we call human beings. But it's really Spirit that's doing all of this. So it's the appropriate activity for Spirit. Spirit is not supposed to be continually pushing this dream into deep forgetfulness. Its responsibility is to push it, is to go towards deep remembrance, go towards choosing a new idea, which gives rise to the overlay, which gives rise to deep remembrance of what Spirit is, so that Spirit can realize that it's impossible for an idea to leave the mind of God. Ideas are extensions from the mind. They don't leave the mind. And all of this is best seen in quiet sitting, without any place to go, no particular place to go, nothing particular to do, nothing to achieve, except to choose a new idea. No need to attain any status. No need to be a hero, an action hero. You might say this world is obsessed with action heroes, action figures. And yet there have been times and places in the world where people valued non-action. But we're a long ways from that now. Long, long ways. People ask each other, what are you doing? What have you been doing? What's your action? I'd say nothing. Basically done nothing. What are you doing? Nothing. I'm not doing anything. Just sitting. Basically, I've spent most of my life just sitting. Not doing much. But sitting for the purpose of quiet reflection. And that has enabled this capacity to see beneath the surface of the situation here. Everything in this world is superficial. It's all on the surface. We're obsessed with the surface of things, surface appearance. We don't look beneath the surface deep enough. Psychology did not provide the tools to look deep enough. It only still looked just barely beneath the surface. That's not sufficient. What happened was, in psychology, a lot of people spent their time reflecting just a little bit beneath the surface, very superficial, not quite on the surface, but a little bit, and then drew conclusions from this as if they had somehow done something in depth. Not true. Was a red herring, because so many people went into therapy and they believed that they had plumbed the depths and then drew conclusions from this as to how to proceed. And this has led to the present impasse, because that seeing that the psychotherapy brought was very, very insufficient depth. Completely overlooked the true depth of the situation. And so the conclusions that were drawn were erroneous. Very, very erroneous. Because the attention was on the persona, the personality, and how to make that persona happy or functioning better. The picture was not big enough. The context was not big enough. The premises were not correct. And so we have an entire world built on this, the suppositions of psychology, which are erroneous, meaning that they wrongly believe that they have plumbed the depths of what's going on, and therefore their conclusions are valid. See, it's a false premise. They've just barely scratched the surface. That's all that happened. All right, good morning from sunny California. All the birds are flying around right now, very active, eating things, berries. Very happy morning. let's talk about the situation that we're in. What else can we talk about, really? Because we're in it. It's always the topic du jour. We're in a situation in the world where ignorance or ignoring. Ignorance means to ignore. To ignore. Ignorance. The state of ignoring what's going on. What's really going on. We're in a state of the world of great, great ignorance. I mean, we're being distracted from what's important to see. We're not seeing what's important. We're ignoring it. That's what it means. And we're in a state of profound, incredible ignorance in this world now. The world is obsessed with action, action figures. Whatever can bring about more and more action, faster action. Write more code, do it now. More action, more change, more innovation. It's obsessed with that. It's ignoring the truly important clarifications as to what the purpose of this world really is. I guarantee you that there is this profound ignorance, and it's become the mantra of the world. Ignore the truth is the mantra of the world. Always has been, but never more so than now. How do we get into this situation where it's so dense? We're sinking. The world is sinking into this extremely dense ignorance, all the while trumpeting this as some sort of success, some great breakthrough. It's like they're saying, we have a great breakthrough into deeper levels of ignorance. And everybody's saying, wow, that's incredible, that's great. Why? Because the purpose of this world is to bring about, induce a deep forgetfulness of what spirit is. Spirit is trying to forget what it is so that it can be something else. So it can believe that it's something else. So it can imagine that it's something else. And what is this something else it wants to be? It wants to be prime creator. That is the crux of the entire situation. It believes it can separate from God. It believes that ideas in the mind of God can separate from the mind of God and set up their own reality, their own kingdom, be prime creators of their own reality. It's not true. Spirit is trying to accomplish this. And this world is the means of forgetfulness that it's employing to forget what it is. To forget that it's actually an idea in the mind of God, extended from the mind of God, but not separate. Therefore, it's not prime creator. It's an extension of the prime creator. It's not exactly the same. Spirit did not originate itself, but it wants to do that, so it has to try and forget what it is. And this world is the means that spirit is using to forget what it is. So, of course, ignorance is all important in this world. And any advances in ignorance are trumpeted here as progress. See, I see things entirely different. The world has it backwards. Here, progress towards ignorance is seen as valuable. It's very, very valuable, as in line with the goals of this of existence, which it is. That is the purpose of existence, to deepen ignorance and the efforts of this world to accomplish that. That's what they're doing. That's what has happened over the last 400 years with the rise of the modern civilization, so to speak, the educational systems. All of that has actually deepened the ignorance of what's going on. And this has been defined as progress. So of course we're scratching our heads saying, you know, it seems like we've been making so much progress, and yet we feel like we're forgetting something, you know, very important. Well, we're forgetting what we are. We're deepening the forgetfulness of what we are, and that has causing us to feel nervous, and people medicating themselves from this nervousness or something, like something's not right. Now, along with all the education that has heightened activity, what has education really done? It's brought about a much, much greater level of activity, speed, engagement with activity. Very few people are simply sitting quietly like this, contemplating. Very, very few. Used to be a lot more that this was seen as very valuable. The quiet contemplative life was seen as the highest value in existence, and the only real value, because it aimed towards remembrance. So, during these times, through education, we have focused on the means of activity, inventions, innovations, doing things faster, doing things on a greater scale, more involvement of your hours in doing stuff, going places, staying very, very active, staying non-contemplative, really. That's been going on for centuries now. And it's culminating in the high-tech age where, you know, everybody is, you know, frantically now trying to keep up with the times. The underpinnings of this are based on what we call psychology, in that what happened was we tried to get rid of this feeling we have within of that we're forgetting something very important by scratching the surface and looking just beneath the surface, just scratching the surface a little bit and looking there, looking at the persona, the personality, and we thought we had plumbed the depths and seen beneath the surface and knew what was taking place in the personality, and then we drew conclusions from that. And these conclusions about the purpose of existence, etc., that psychology has given the world are erroneous, because psychology has not plumbed the depths at all. It's avoided plumbing the depths by focusing on superficials that are just barely beneath the surface and thinking, well, that somehow they have, you know, been able to see entirely the full picture of what's taking place here, and then draw conclusions from that. And so this culture is based on those conclusions. And they're entirely erroneous. Psychology says we understand the human situation, and this is what we need to do to make everyone happy, and humans need to do this, they need to be active, they need to do this and that and that. All erroneous conclusions. Very, very severely erroneous. So many people have gone through therapy, psychological therapy, and believe that they have somehow gained insight into their purpose and some deeper understanding, gotten in touch with their feelings, etc. That is just, you know, still extremely superficial. And so we have a culture of those who believe they know, but they don't. And then this leaves the culture wide open for exploitation by those who simply want to push forgetfulness. Because it's very easy for them to say that they're helping out the psychology of people. Very easy for them to claim that. But for those who understand the true purpose here, which is to contemplate, quietly contemplate and develop clarity, and to see the actual purpose of this, of existence, is to induce a deep forgetfulness of what spirit really is, that we're really spirit, we're not humans, we're not personas, none of this. The humans and personas and personalities are only devices that induce deep forgetfulness in us, devices for us to identify with, to believe in. If one has seen this and knows this to be true, then it's easy to not be exploited by those whose only purpose is to deepen the ignorance here, because you know that their aims are not in alignment with the purpose here, and they cannot so easily make such claims, pass off such counterfeit bills. So psychology was really paving the way for the exploitation that is taking place right now on this planet by those who have crashed the planet, hacked into the planet, basically. We have a culture of hackers who have hacked into the planet culture here. And they know it. They're very boastful about it. Bragging about it. You know, we came in and hacked this world. Hacking is not only computers, it's also worlds. Worlds are hacked. This world has been hacked. And hackers put in viruses. This world has had a virus put into it, severely bugged with ignorance, misdirection, mispurpose, misuse of time, wrong focus, all of that. And it was paved, that way was paved by superficial discoveries of psychology, making us think that, somehow we've discovered something that is more important than the perennial wisdom. No, it's just that the perennial wisdom bypassed all that superficial stuff. It said it's not important. So it's not that psychology came up with new discoveries. It simply was looking in a very superficial area that had not been emphasized. So it was just a new emphasis, but it was an emphasis on the superficial and the non-important. And then this laid the groundwork for the hackers to come in and easily claim that they were in alignment with helping the world. Whereas the perennial wisdom, through the great teachings of history, had the right emphasis, and as such were not so vulnerable to being hacked. They had a very good antivirus program, so to speak. You might say the great teachings in history are like antivirus programs. Firewalls that prevented the world from being hacked, but eventually the hackers finally managed to hack this world system here. And plunge the world into misemphasis. But the problem of the world now is wrong emphasis. It's a worldwide problem everywhere. The emphasis is on the superficial, on that which continues to induce deep forgetfulness. And so all of us are dwelling within this situation of emphasizing ignorance, and it's very difficult. As Shakespeare said, "It's much ado about nothing, this world. Everyone's just actors upon a stage strutting around, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing." So we have these world hackers who are now in control of this planet, you know, strutting around, feeling that they've done something really, really amazing. You know, hackers that feel they've accomplished something really incredible by hacking a system, which is system hackers. But what's been brought here is profound ignorance. Technology is really profound ignorance. High technology, profound ignorance. Profound misemphasis, profound misdirection. Inducing deep, deep forgetfulness. And it's like everybody is joining up with others to reinforce that ignorance. Say, hey, how you doing? Are you remaining very ignorant? They say, yeah, I am. I'm really working hard on the ignorance. They say, oh, that's great. I am too. Really having some great forgetfulness of what I am. Very successful at that. And they say, yeah, me too. I'm having even greater success than ever at forgetting what I am. And I say, wow, that's really great. Let's all get together and see if we can increase it even more. That's basically the interaction of this world. That's what it is. How can we induce even greater forgetfulness? So why are we doing this? Because we want to be prime creator. So there is a goal. There's a belief that if the forgetfulness becomes profound enough, that somehow magically we will enter a transcendent blissful condition of being prime creators, which is will be better than anything we had before. That's the premise. It's a false premise. Ideas cannot leave the mind of God. Ideas cannot transcend what extended them in the first place. Effects cannot transcend ideas. Effects cannot choose to which idea they serve. They cannot separate from what idea that gave rise to them that, and become their own cause. None of that is possible. It's literally impossible. And yet here we are in the world with everyone in this world believing it is possible. And the way to do it is to reach some sort of total forgetfulness. And of course that's impossible. And yet we keep trying. The world clearly believes it is possible. So there's a great divide among those who know it's impossible and those who believe it is possible. Total divide. Two sides of a fence. And then the remedy that those who say it's possible say, well, let's just sit on the fence and say it's both possible and impossible. What kind of remedy is that? It's no remedy at all. Clearly, it's a delaying tactic. Because those who say that it's impossible, they're not giving up. Those who say that it is possible are not going to give up their belief simply by having those who believe it is impossible to sit on a fence and say, well, maybe it is possible. That's what compromise is, isn't it? Sitting on a fence saying, well, I'm not really sure what to think. I don't know. So the idea of sitting on a fence is basically saying to those who know it's impossible to give that knowing up and to say, well, I don't really know. I don't know. I don't really know. Not sure. It might be possible. That's what it is. That's what it's being asked of. So it's literally being asked to be plunged into ignorance. How can spirit not know what it is and what is possible? It's impossible for spirit to give that up because spirit remains in the mind of God and God knows perfectly well. So spirit also knows perfectly well. So to sit on the fence and say, well, I don't know if it's possible or impossible, I really don't know. That's deep, 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 deep ignorance. What kind of compromise is that, really? Is those who believe it is possible, are they giving anything up? No. It's a deception to think that there's some sort of compromise. That's the deepest deception that traps us all, is the belief that we need to be fair and accept some sort of compromise. Which means, really, accept insanity, accept not knowing what we are. Where does that get us? It only delay. It's only delay. Because we have to remember what we are. Because God will never forget what we are. And we are an extension in the mind of the Prime Creator. Therefore, we will always know what we are. So the entire situation of trying to forget what we are is nothing but delay. It's all that it is. All these attempts at compromise, that's simply delay. It's basically saying, wait a little while I work on how to get you to forget even more. So when those who believe that it's possible to totally forget what we are face those who say, well, it's impossible to do this. Their only purpose is to delay until they can figure out a way to get them to forget, how to increase the forgetfulness. They say, okay, let's just shelve this. Let's sit on the fence for a while, and we'll get back to it in a little while. And what do? They then go to work on deeper forgetting. I've seen this for a fact. That's how it works. They won't agree. They'll say, well, maybe, I don't know, I'm not really sure. Let's put this aside for right now. And then they go to work frantically, trying to deepen their forgetfulness. So it's a delaying tactic. It's not a compromise. There's no such thing as compromise between two mutually exclusive positions. It's not possible. Either one can completely forget what one is, or not. It's either or. Either something is zero, or it's a number that has value. Cannot be both. Cannot be a number that has value and has no value at the same time. So there is no compromise. The ego is misrepresenting this position by claiming it's seeking compromise. No, it's not. It's seeking temporary cessation of involvement with remembering so that it can work on ways to forget more deeply. Always that is the way, which is why it's very important to go along the path of remembrance very quickly, without cessation, without stopping. As soon as one halts, the ego jumps in with tactics to forget, to plunge back into ignorance. That's the actual situation here in this world. There is no common ground between those who, the position of impossible and not impossible. There's no common ground there. Either one or the other. It's all important. The perennial great teachings always brought this to light and said, you're either, like Jesus said, you're either for me or against me. Meaning, you either believe it's impossible or possible. You either believe the impossible is impossible, or you believe the impossible is possible. Those are mutually exclusive positions. So he said, either, you know, for me or against me. There's not some third possibility. And yet the ego insists, oh no, there's some third possibility. That is a lie. It's merely buying time to strengthen its own position of forgetfulness. That's all that's happening here. So there's no need to engage in those delays. And the ego said, it will say, you're not being fair. You're not giving me time to work on forgetfulness. To work on the impossible. You're not giving me time. Well, the ego's had billions and billions and billions of years. And they will always ask for more time. What else can it do? What else can the attempt to accomplish the impossible do except to ask for more time? More cooperation. That's all it can do. You say, well, where's the results? Well, there's no results, but we need more time. So the ego will, you must always insist, more time. Forget it. It's useless. The ego will insist that you must wait for the results that it's going to bring about. Again, it will always insist that you wait. Wait a little longer. More time, more waiting. The ego says, insists that it can find the answer. The ego insists that there is an answer somewhere, and it's going to find it. You just have to wait. Well, what it is feeling vaguely as an answer is to choose the overlay. But the ego cannot choose the overlay. So when the ego says it knows there's an answer, that's a half-truth. And then to fill out that, the fullness of that, it knows that there's an answer, but it cannot never provide the answer, this answer, because the ego is just works at the level of effects. The answer is to choose a different idea. It's like the effects of an idea saying, well, I know there's an answer. But the effects of an idea will always be in line with the idea. Effects cannot choose a new idea. So we keep feeling there's an answer, and we keep turning to the ego. And the ego, and we think the ego, you know, should be able to find it for us, and it never does. Because it cannot. The ego did not originate itself. The ego is actually a presentation of mind. And mind is serving the idea that spirit gave to it, the idea of wanting to be prime creator. And the effects that come from mind's presentation are always in alignment with that idea. They cannot serve a different idea. So this feeling of there's an answer is coming from spirit. It's not coming from ego. It's not coming from mind. It's spirit saying, you know, all I have to do is choose a new idea, and that'll solve things. But then it's trying to get ego to do the choosing, to be in charge of it all. And ego twists this, turns it upside down and backwards, and thinks that the answer is for it to succeed at its purpose, which is to complete forgetfulness. And these are the battles, the struggles that we find ourselves engaged in as we attempt to clarify the wasting of time. We become aware that this is all a waste of time. It's very frustrating, but it's better to be aware of it than not aware of it, because most in the world are unaware that they're wasting their time. Whereas those who are clarifying this become aware, oh, I'm wasting my time. Totally wasting my time. Not getting anywhere. Not succeeding at all. This is all a waste of time. There's that acute feeling. So it's acute feeling that one has to feel. And that brings about a greater focus. Saying, wait a minute, how can I not keep wasting my time? The ego will continuously waste our time, life after life after life. Almost got it. Almost completed the situation for us. Almost brought fulfillment for us. Almost succeeded. Always it will have this feeling like I've almost got it. But almost is never enough. It's like saying it's almost accomplished the impossible. That's what it's saying. That it's almost accomplished the impossible. Well, what does that mean? What's the meaning of that statement? What it's basically saying is I haven't yet accomplished the impossible. What else can it say? The ego can never say that it's impossible to accomplish the impossible. It can't view things that way. It's not able to view things that way at all. Because it's really the dynamic presentation of mind, of the idea of spirit being trying to be prime creator. So that dynamic has to continuously try. Continuously try. It cannot give up trying. So all it can do is say, well, I haven't quite reached it yet. But that's a statement is meaning I'm still trying. The ego can never give up. Can never give up. And so we're waiting for the ego to give up and surrender and say, okay, that's it. I surrender. I give up. I can't do it. No, that will never happen. It will only be a conditional surrender. The idea that somehow we have to surrender, the ego has to surrender, is impossible. Cannot do it. We have to choose a new idea. We have to give mind a new idea. And then mind will present that idea. The idea of not trying to be prime creator. The mind presents this as an overlay of everything that has arisen in the attempt to forget what we are. Now we have an effect that is totally unaffected by forgetfulness. It knows what it is, an effect that doesn't change, isn't altered in any way, that reminds us of what we are. All we need is an effect that reminds us of what we are. That's it. And the overlay is that effect. That's what works. Not the ego saying that it's almost got it. But always say that. The ego will say it's almost surrendered. Almost surrendered. Almost given up its purpose. It cannot give up its purpose. Because if it did, that would prove that effects can leave cause, can leave ideas. That would prove that spirit can leave the mind of God. If the ego could give up, that would be really the complete undoing of reality. But the ego cannot give up. The ego claims that if you choose a new idea, that means the ego gave up, which means that spirit has been able to separate from God. Not true. Choosing a new idea doesn't mean the ego gives up. It means simply that you have new effects from a new idea. It has nothing to do with the ego surrendering or giving up. The ego falsely claims that to frighten us. And so we've managed to make our way to the crux of the matter. The ego misinterprets choosing a new idea as if it means that ego is giving up its efforts. Not true. It just simply means that a new idea is being experienced. The old idea of trying to be prime creator, that idea and its effects are entirely one. That idea will always express itself as an effort to try and accomplish the impossible. It will never surrender. The effects cannot. No effect can cease arising from the idea that gave rise to it. It's impossible. So the ego can misinterpret what enlightenment is, misinterprets to frighten us away from it. Because rightly so, if we thought that means that effects can separate from cause, of course we're not going to do that. We'll feel that we'll be annihilated, which we would be if that could take place, but it cannot. So we cannot be held hostage by the false conclusions of the ego. The ego will say, well, what happened to me? You know, what happened to me? Nothing. The effects of the idea of trying to be prime creator, those effects will always arise from that idea. But now we are choosing a different idea, and the effects of that are arising from that idea. The ego's motivations are still there. Everything is still exactly the same, except they're not being experienced anymore. The overlay is being experienced. The overlay is non-negation. It's not trying to get rid of anything. Just that, so the ego simply seems to have no more importance, that the dynamics of existence don't touch the overlay, do not affect it in any way. It's not that these effects have given up being what they are. We've chosen a different idea with different effects. So this differentiation is all important. Otherwise, we will remain trapped by the fear, what the ego's telling us, that somehow success means the ego has to surrender. Has to give up. That's not it at all. Total misinterpretation by the ego to frighten us away. And seek for different answers. If we do see this, we'll say, aha! No wonder why I've been reluctant. Because I think that in choosing a new idea, it really is the surrender of the ego. No, the ego is not involved in the choosing of a new idea. It's not affecting the ego at all. doesn't do anything to it. It doesn't matter what the ego does anymore. It's not a surrender. It's irrelevant because it's a different idea. The ego doesn't arise in this different idea. So the ego takes that this non-arising of the ego in this different idea means the ego has surrendered. No, there's no ego there in the first place. With the new idea, there is no ego there in the first place. There is no attempt to forget what we are there in the first place. It's not that the ego was there, but it's been destroyed or surrendered or given up. No, that's completely false. The overlay is exactly what it is from the very beginning. It's completely perfect from the very beginning. There's not a trace of change or forgetfulness of what it is at all. The overlay knows what it is. It's self-aware. It's aware of itself perfectly. It's unchanging. Perfect peace, perfect love, seamless. No judgment, no distinction. It simply overlays all that arises. There's no dynamic of forgetfulness there, of deceit, of lies, no ego there, no being devices being employed. So the idea that somehow the overlay is a situation where the ego has been defeated is completely false. There never was an ego in the overlay. There never was an attempt by the overlay to forget what it is. Never an attempt from the effects of this idea to separate from the cause. Ego will be interested in this, thinking, well, how did you get rid of the ego along with the overlay so it's right now? No, it was right from the very beginning. It's always been perfectly in alignment with itself. Perfect from the beginning, perfect now, perfect always, flawless. Non-negation, so nothing's being negated. But the ego is intrigued by this, thinking, must have been something bad and wrong, and somehow it cured it, it fixed it, it healed it. No, not true. So the ego misinterprets what the overlay is, and then feeds us this misinterpretation and tells us to work on these problems and figure out. There's nothing to figure out. There's nothing to work on. That's the ego's misinterpretation. Again, the overlay overlays that misinterpretation as well. The overlay is not concerned with figuring itself out. It knows what it is. It knows itself from the very beginning. It knows itself to be endless. It has always known this. The ego cannot understand this at all. Because the ego's purpose is to forget what it is, to deny what it is, to deny the truth, to bring about forgetfulness, bring about negation. Ego may seem intrigued by this, but it's not really. Its intrigues are superficial and only relating to its viewpoint. Thinking that the answer has something to do with healing, of curing something, of getting better, fixing something. Something that was broken. Nothing's been broken. The overlay has never been broken. Spirit's never been broken. That's why the overlay reminds us of what we are. So here again, we are able to discover a deep, deep hang-up that we have, that is ego's misinterpretation of the overlay in trying to guide us to work on its misinterpretation as if that means spiritual progress. No, it's simply delay. It's holding us up. The ego wants us to try and find out in the overlay, how did it heal things? How did it stitch itself together? How did it put the fragments together, etc.? Because the ego knows that it needs to keep telling us it has an answer, a cure for our problems, that it can heal our dissatisfaction. But there's no dissatisfaction in the overlay at all. There never has been any. There's no answer to give to the ego at all. So the ego then says, well, if there's no answer to give the ego, then it's not helpful for the world. Well, it's not helpful for the ego. But but there's no way the ego can be helped because it's trying to accomplish the impossible. There's no help for that. The ego cannot be helped. It's doing its job perfectly well, which is to deceive. But no amount of deception will result in spirit leaving the mind of God. None. So the ego is simply wasting time, just spinning its wheels. It will always spin its wheels. There's no cure for that. But we can choose a different idea. And so the ego spinning its wheels doesn't matter what at all to us anymore, because we've given up the attempt to forget what we are. So what do we need it for? We don't need the attempt to forget what we are anymore. We allow it to be there simply so that it be overlaid, so that the overlay has something to overlay. It provides continuity. But what the ego is doing or not doing doesn't make any difference anymore. So we can approach this type of clarity, which in the past has been approached also. There have even been times and places where there's a culture of clarity, where these types of considerations are the norm. And they work through to the point where there are those who do choose to overlay a new idea. They choose again, different idea. And they're freed from the terrible ravages of the idea of trying to forget what they are. It has been done in history, no question about it. And so we need to do it right now as well. We're not freed from the responsibility of doing that. We absolutely are responsible to do it. And these investigations have to be very deep into the ego's motives. We cannot simply sit on the superficial. That doesn't get us anywhere at all. It just wastes our time. So I make these videos so that they do not waste your time, because they get to the very, very root of the situation, that the hold-ups, the hang-ups, that are actually causing us to hesitate. Those are being examined here, held up to the light, and so at least we get a glimpse of them, and we recognize, that's where the trouble is. The ego is misrepresenting the solution and telling us we need to somehow find an answer which isn't there. The ego, like that, tells us, well, you must find an answer. How did the overlay heal itself? You know, there is no answer for that, because it was never sick in the first place. And then the ego will say, well, then there's really no point in investigating it, because what we really need to do is we need to figure out how to heal existence. No, we don't. We do not. The healing of existence is not the goal. The overlay of existence is the goal. You see that? Have to see it that way. If you don't see it that way, the ego will absolutely have its way with you. And you will feel powerless to resist it. The ego will say you have to find the answer, how to fix things, how to heal things. And you will feel like you just have to go along with it. But if you see it the way that's being presented here, you will just dismiss that like a little bug flying around. Just wave your hand and just wave the bug away and say, no. No, there is no cure for existence, except the overlay replaces the different idea. Existence is what it is. The only cure for deep forgetfulness is deep remembrance. And existence will never provide deep remembrance, because its purpose is deep forgetfulness. That comes from an idea. Facts cannot change the idea that they serve at all. So there is no fix. Existence cannot find its own fix other than the overlay. The overlay is the fix. It's the only one there is. There's not some second one. There's not some changing of the effects of existence. It doesn't work. The ego to keep us going in that direction. Because it knows that doesn't work. It knows that trying to heal existence doesn't work. That is simply a completely futile effort. It knows this. And that's why it tries to get us in that direction continuously. Fix the world. Heal the world. Heal the planet. Integrate things. Cooperate, etc. All of that, the ego knows it doesn't work. So it sponsors that to the ultimate extent. It's always up there banging the drum saying, come on everybody, let's be spiritual. Let's heal the planet. Let's love one another. Let's do all this. That's the ego who's doing that because it knows that is distracting us from what really works, which is to choose a different idea. Choose the overlay. Because the whole game is to remember what we are, and existence will not give us that remembrance at all. If we've forgotten what we are, how do we know that existence can remind us? That's the question. How does anyone know what will work? Well, you have to have faith in those who have remembered what they are. Unfortunately, I've come in contact with those who have truly remembered what they are, who know what they are, that spirit in the mind of God. And they say, this is what works, and this is what doesn't work. And then you look at that and examine it carefully, and then you see, aha, I can see it too. It's very evident. The ego is just tricking everyone with all the spirituality of let's you know, heal. Let's bring about healing. Let's fix what's wrong. No, that's not the way. The overlay is the way. The overlay doesn't fix anything. Doesn't heal anything. Doesn't need to because it's perfectly well. Without any possibility of not being well. Doesn't need to be protected. Doesn't need to take vitamins or medication. Doesn't need to work out. Doesn't need to go anywhere. Doesn't need to learn anything. The overlay is flawless. That's what reminds us of what we are. See, what we need is what reminds us of what we actually are in the goals of existence. Don't do that. This is the perennial theme. This is what has to be harped on continuously because it's so incredibly important. Because we are continuously tricked by the ego into its spirituality. The ego sponsors spirituality. It's the cheerleader. It's the one that brings all of the spirituality to the planet. Knowing that the pursuit of that distracts you from what actually works. So it's very easy to go through a lifetime after lifetime after lifetime engaged in what one believes is really very productive, positive, helpful, world-affirming spirituality that is, you know, the right thing and the righteous thing to do and get absolutely nowhere, only deep in delusion. It happens continuously. Because the ego is desperate for you, not my idea. It knows that's its kryptonite, that's its Achilles heel, and the game is up then. So it will offer anything, any substitute for that. It will claim it will elevate you to the heights of creativity. It will elevate you to wherever it can within the effects of existence, as long as this distracts you from choosing a new idea. That is the truth. That is what my teachers have taught me. Two primary teachers, Jesus Christ and Anamayama, both of those teachers teaching the same thing, essentially. There are no exceptions to truth. None. And that the game of distraction involves a tremendous amount of obsession with spirituality. And that there's only one answer, that is to choose a new idea. And Anamayama says the vision of oneness is one way of putting it. You can put it in many other ways. The vision of oneness means a vision of the overlay. It's the only way. Jesus said there's only one way. That's correct. Vision of the overlay is the only way. So what about all the rest of the spirituality? You know, the chakras and the kundalini and the energies and the bliss and blah, blah, blah. You know, endless, endless spirituality in this world. You look for it, it's a vast swamp. It's all distraction, direction. It's all the ego. Knowing that it's vulnerable to you choosing a new idea and desperate to provide a substitute for all of that, for choosing a new idea, a substitute for it by presenting all these other options. Candy store. Of stuff to do. That tells you that you're healing the world. You're healing the separation. There's no separation. There's no separation to heal. Never been any separation. You only need to remember that. And you cannot remember it except through the overlay. That is the means to remember it. It's the only means. The idea that somehow we can remember this in some other way is delusional. And then there again, we choose the delusional way because we believe the ego's lies, as pointed out previously in this video, that somehow that choosing a new idea means the ego has surrendered. It's not true. Somehow that the ego, that effects of this idea have been able to separate from the cause. Not true. That leaves out the fact that we've chosen a different idea, a new idea. The ego keeps thinking that somehow there's a way to get the effects of this idea to change the purpose that they serve, to change the idea they serve. Not true. No. New idea is an overlay of all these effects. It doesn't change them. Overlays them. So I keep harping on this over and over and over and over. Because if you can just get a glimmer of this, if you can just intuitively one day look and say, ah, I see it, just for an instant, that will save you immeasurable time, immeasurable suffering, immeasurable enmeshment in futility. It will literally save you from that. Vast amounts of time will be saved if it's just one simple glimpse of it. So that's why I keep harping on this, keep producing these videos, because it only takes one little glimpse. One little glimpse is sufficient. And you'll see it and you'll say, oh my gosh. It's very simple. The ego has been fooling me, misdirecting me, leading me astray, leading me away from what works. And how does the ego do that? Well, the ego has to use everything it can to accomplish this. And it has to provide something very attractive. Whatever it takes to catch our attention, and the ego say, you know what? This is just as good, if not better, so why don't you try this spirituality? And again, the leverage the ego has is it's telling you that if you choose a new idea and are free from the ego, that means the ego is surrendered, which means effects can separate from cause. And that would result in your annihilation. So it has this leverage on you. So as you approach choosing a new idea, you'll suddenly get frightened and the ego will then present a distraction for you, some type of glamorous, some type of spirituality for you, and you'll grab a hold of that and think, this is the answer. This saved me from annihilation. See that? So we have to keep on focusing, drilling into this. With a roto hammer, you know. Pow, 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 pow. Drilling through the concrete. It's hard work, a lot of dust, etc. But eventually you get the glimpse through the concrete. And you see, aha. There is something on the other side of that concrete. The ego is falsely represented what the overlay is. Uses that false representation to frighten us away from the overlay. And then present some substitute for the overlay, some sort of glamorous spirituality where you're supposed to, you know, heal the world, save the world, provide some high culture for the world, do something that elevates people, all that. And you think, wow, I can be a hero of the dream. That's great. And then off you go on that, off on a tangent. You might spend an entire lifetime doing that, or two, or three. Or you might spend one day at it. Or you might spend an hour at it. Or you might reject it immediately. All right. Oh, there's some distraction there. Okay, I see what it is. No problem. Back to work, you see? There was a... So there's some very, very strange noises taking place. And I said, what in the world is that? Well, I took a quick peek, saw what it was. I said, okay, back to work now. So, the ego is the great distractor. In order to overcome this, one has to see through the ego's leverage that it has. In order to see through the leverage, one has to do very, very in-depth clarification. Focus right at it. What is it? In order to do that, one has to put side by side the remedy and the idea that it's replacing. Choosing an idea, a new idea, doesn't destroy the other idea. It simply deactivates it. It's like a seed that's not being watered anymore. The plant, sort of as if a tree shrunk down back into a seed. You don't chop the tree down, you don't burn it down. This is as if the tree, you have a tree and it morphs down, melts down, and shrinks back into a seed. And there is just a little seed there now. And that's the idea. If one doesn't choose an idea, the idea is not activated. Or in the case of the overlay, one simply allows everything that is all the effects of an idea, simply overlays those effects. So the tree is still there, everything is still there, but one is experiencing the overlay of all those effects. But once one finally drops of even the overlay and chooses to know, spirit to know what it is directly, then existence, the idea of forgetting, is no longer activated at all. No need for it to be activated at all. And so it's like a seed. But the seed, everything is still there in the seed form. If one wants to water the seed again, then this idea will have its effects again. That's reality. That's reality. That's how reality works. So nothing is destroyed. Nothing is negated. It's a question of what does spirit want to experience. The fact that spirit will choose a different idea doesn't mean that the previous idea is destroyed. Not at all. Still entirely there within the mind of God. All ideas are within the mind of God. Even the idea of trying to separate from the mind of God, that is also in the mind of God. It's always there as a potential to be chosen. Always. So there's no destruction of anything. No negation of anything. The ego falsely claims that there is, that the overlay means the ego's been destroyed. That is false. It means the ego has been overlaid. Gigantic difference. All important difference. It removes the ego's leverage and then enables us to stop pursuing false goals, pursuing those things that don't work. Of course, if we want to fool ourselves, we need to pursue something that we think will work, that looks very, very promising or glamorous or important or spiritual to us. That's why we have to continually remind ourselves only the overlay works. There's only one remedy that works, not two, not ten, not a thousand. There may be infinite ways to prepare, to prep for choosing a new idea. But there's only one idea that works, the overlay. The idea of not trying to be prime creator, that's the only remedy. That's the only remedy that brings about remembrance of what spirit is. It's the only way for spirit to remember what it is. It's the only way. It's only one way, not many. And we need to remind ourselves of that constantly. So as we progressively become less entangled in false ways. So be patient, be persistent, and just catch a glimpse of this. It's very, very possible to catch a glimpse. It may seem that you're not getting it, but there's only one thing to get, really, That is a glimpse. You get the glimpse and see. Just for a second. Just for a moment. You suddenly take a look and say, aha. And right then and there, you may have saved yourself countless incarnations. Definitely have saved yourself just by one little glimpse. It's that aha, aha moment, aha. So that's it. And then, of course, you're going to fall back into forgetfulness again. But you have a different orientation. You have leverage now. You say, no, you know the ego is fooling you. You know it. You just kind of forget exactly how it was fooling you. But that's why you listen. That's why you listen. I listen to my teachers. Then I listen to, then I clarify, contemplate and clarify. Work on that, because they said do that. Work on clarification. So that's what I do. So I don't forget so much. I'm able to bring this remembrance back again and again and again. But the potential for forgetfulness is still present. But it's easier because I worked at it for so long. But I only started working on it because I got a glimpse of truth. I saw it for just a moment. Just a moment. I saw it very clearly. I said, ah, we're being tricked here. We're being fooled. The ego's fooling us. It's causing us to chase after all these red herrings. Pursue all these false paths that don't work. They look promising, but they don't work. The situation's actually very simple. Just choose a new idea. I caught a glimpse of the totality of the situation. It's all very clear. And then I said, uh-oh, I'm going to forget this. And then I said, okay, I'm going to forget it, but I know it's there to be seen, so I just have to work at seeing it. And then just go to work. It's like that. That's what happens. And then I found that the efforts of others who have seen it are very helpful to keep reminding me. And that's the transmission of this remembrance, transmission of reminding that the remembrance is there simply by choosing a new idea, by experiencing, abiding in the overlay, being submerged in the overlay, the experiencing of the overlay. That is the one and only remedy. That's what brings the deep remembrance of what we are. This fact needs to be transmitted, continually transmitted here. And there are those who to transmit, and there are those who listen. It's like a broadcast on a radio. Someone's broadcasting the game and other people are listening to it. So, very great. Just get that glimpse. That's it.